worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Holy, holy is He. Sing a new song to Him who sits on heaven's mercy seat. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Holy, holy is He. Sing a new song to Him who sits on heaven's mercy seat. Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty, who was and is to come. With all creation I will sing praise to the King of Kings. You are my everything, and I will adore You. Clothed in rainbows of living colors, flashes of lightning, rolls of thunder. Blessing and honor, strength and glory and power be to You, the only wise King. Is the Lord God Almighty, who was and is to come. With all creation I will sing praise to the King of Kings. You are my everything, and I will adore You. Awestruck wonder at the mention of Your name. Jesus, Your name is power, breath and living water, such a marvelous mystery. Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty, who was and is to come. With all creation I will sing praise to the King of Kings. You are my everything, and I will adore You. hunger and thirst. A hunger and thirst. Arms stretched wide, I know you hear my cry. Speak to me now. Speak to me now. I surrender. I surrender. I want to know you more. I want to know you more. I surrender.
I raise a hallelujah. lost your hold on me. Yeah. Oh, I'm gonna sing in the middle of the storm. Louder and louder, you're gonna hear my praises roar. Up from the ashes, hope will arise. 'Cause death is defeated, the King is alive.
Hello, and it is such a pleasure to welcome you back to Bandung International Church to BIC Online.
We're Pastor and Prof. Kay Waldemar and Rosemary Kowalski, and we're the leaders at Bandung International Church. And as you can see, we're in our office this morning, and it's a bit noisy outside. Somebody is cutting the grass or using a weed whacker or something. I don't know if you're in the quiet, if you're in the noise, but we hope that your heart has already begun to fill up. We usually start about 15 minutes before 9 o'clock. And that gives you time to just unwind, to let the week go, and to open your heart in worship to what God wants to do. We hope that you are going to fill your heart with the presence of God with us this morning.
Let us worship our King. Come, let us bow at His feet. He has done great things. See what our Savior has done. See how His love overcomes. He has done great things. He has done great things. Hero of heaven, you conquer the grave. You free every captive and break every chain. Oh God, you have done great things. We dance in your presence, awaken alive. Oh Jesus, our Savior, your name lifted high. Oh God, you have done great. Every storm, you've been faithful forevermore. You have done great things, and I know you will do it again. For your promise is yes and amen. You will do great things. God, you do great things.
Come on, we sing, church.
Heaven, you conquer the grave. You free every captive and break every chain. Oh God, you have done great things. We dance in your freedom, awaken alive. Oh Jesus, our Savior, your name lifted high. Oh God, you have done great things.
Come on. Come on, we sing.
Hallelujah, God, above it all. Hallelujah, God, unshakable. Hallelujah, you have done great things.
Come on, all we clap together.
Oh, hallelujah, God, above it all. Hallelujah, God, unshakable. Done
done great things. Come on.
Oh, hero of heaven, you conquer the grave. You free every captive and break every chain. Oh, God, you have done great things. We dance in your freedom, awaken the light. Oh, Jesus, our Savior, your name lifted high. Oh, God, you have done great things. You have done great things. Oh, God, you do great things.
Advent packs. Every family or household who regularly comes to BIC can have one of these. And there's a devotional in there for every week to follow along, but there's also treats. Some wonderful things. I'm not going to tell you what they are because you'll have to get your own pack to see what they are. Two kinds. First is for people with no children, and the second is for a family with children. And just let us know how many kids so we have enough things for your children. But how do you get one? Pick it up from the Jaga at Green Gate, which is our regular meeting place, and just sign in that you've got it either Monday, Tuesday, or Wednesday this week. On Thursday, we're going to start delivering, so make sure that we have your current address. Okay, communitybic@gmail.com. Make sure we've got your address because you won't want to miss it. And we're going to have a Merry Christmas together.
Good morning. Bible reading today is from 2 Samuel 7, 5-7. Go and speak to my servant David. Tell him, the Lord says, are you the one to build me a house to live in? I have not lived in a house from the day I brought the people of Israel up out of Egypt until now. I have been moving from place to place. I have been living in a tent. I have moved from place to place with all of the people of Israel. I commanded their rulers to be shepherds over them. I never asked any of their rulers, why haven't you built me a house that has beautiful cedar walls? I tell you that I myself will set up a royal house for you. Someday your life will come to an end. You will join the members of your family who have already died. Then I will make one of your own sons the next king after you, and I will make his kingdom secure. He is the one who will build a house where I will put my name. I will set up the throne of his kingdom. It will last forever. With all his heart, my father David wanted to build a temple. He wanted to do it so the Lord could put his name there. The Lord is the God of Israel. But the Lord spoke to my father David. He said, with all your heart you wanted to build a temple for my name. It is good that you wanted to do that. But you will not build the temple. Instead, your son will build the temple for my name. He is your own flesh and blood. The Lord has kept the promise he made. I've become the next king after my father David. Now I'm sitting on the throne of Israel. That's exactly what the Lord promised would happen. I've built the temple where the Lord will put his name. He is the God of Israel. But will you really live on earth after all the heavens can hold you? In fact, even the highest heavens can hold you. So this temple I've built, it certainly can hold you. But please pay attention to my prayer. Lord my God, show me your favor as I make my appeal to you. Listen to my cry for help. Hear the prayer I'm praying for you today. Let your eyes look toward this temple night and day. You say, I will put my name there. So please listen to the prayer I'm praying toward this place. Hear me when I ask you to show us your favor. Listen to your people Israel when they pray toward this place. Listen to us from heaven. It's the place where you live. When you hear us, forgive us.
Matthew 28, verse 18 to 20. Then Jesus came to them. He said, "All authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. So you must go and make disciples of all nations. Baptize them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Teach them to obey everything I have commanded you. And you can be sure that I am always with you to the very end." Acts 1:8. "But you will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes on you. Then you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem. You will be my witnesses in all Judea and Samaria, and you will be my witnesses from one end of the earth to the other." Acts 8, verse 1 to 4. Saul was there. He had agreed that Stephen should die. On that day, the church in Jerusalem began to attack and treat it badly. All except the upper cell were scattered throughout Judea and Samaria. Godly Jews buried Stephen. They sobbed over him. But Saul began to destroy the church. He went from house to house. He dragged men and women away and put them in prison. The believers who had been scattered preached the word everywhere they went. 1 Corinthians 6:19. "Don't you know that your bodies are temples of the Holy Spirit? The Spirit is in you. You have received Him from God. You do not belong to yourselves." This is the words of the Lord. Thank you.
So here we are at the end of our series called Follow Jesus. Thank you for making this journey with us. Although the series is finishing, the journey itself is continuing. The last things Jesus said to his followers, at least as they are recorded in the stories we have, were that his followers are to go out, and that is our first big idea.
Through the whole series and in the many stories we have of Jesus as a human, we've seen ways of following him, ways of being healthy, ways of growing in him. You know, Jesus sends us, but he doesn't send us out empty when we go. And that's our second big idea. Don't go empty. Go full.
And if you want to review some of the ways Jesus helps us to prepare, our talks are available on our BIC YouTube channel as well as on Facebook.
When God made Adam and Eve, he put them in a beautiful setting where he could walk with them and live among them. Adam and Eve chose their own path rather than what God gave them. They didn't trust God and they rejected him. So they had to leave the Garden of Eden, that original beautiful setting. But God did not abandon his people.
He met with them. He met with Abraham, had dinner with him, and actually spoke with him on a number of occasions. And as Dave reminded us last week, he met with Jacob, the deceiver. He wrestled with him and then renamed him Israel, which means struggles with God. And from Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, or later Israel, God created a nation, a large group of people.
When God rescued his people, Israel, from their slavery in Egypt, he had Moses and the people build a tent for him, which they called the tabernacle. It traveled with the people on their journey because God wanted to live in the middle of them. He wanted to be where his people were. After they sinned and worshipped an image of a golden calf, God's tent moved outside the camp.
But God still wanted the people to visit him, to come to him. It seems like only Moses and Joshua regularly came into the tent of meeting and into God's presence. And later on, the high priest would enter once a year.
And then, as we heard in the readings, David wanted to build God a better place to live, a temple. It didn't seem right that God's people had nice houses, David had a palace, and God only had a tent. So God says, okay, but we're going to have your son Solomon build that temple. And we heard about the dedication of that building.
Yeah, so we have houses to protect us, to keep us safe from weather and other threats. And we know God doesn't need that. Besides, as God said through Nathan the prophet in David's time, God cannot be confined or caged up. People wanted to build God a permanent place to live, but God never asked for that. Yet he allowed David to plan for and Solomon to build a place, the temple, a place where God's blessing and presence could be experienced. It was a place for Israel to visit with God.
And so the way for people to feel God's presence during this time before Christ's birth.
And yeah, we're a week away from Advent. And let me just say, there are Advent packets coming. If you're a member of BIC, make sure that we have your address and that you write us, okay?
So we're getting ready to celebrate Christ's birth. And in the period of time before Christ was born, how did you feel God's presence? Well, you visited Jerusalem. You went to the temple. The model for receiving God's blessing was to come in, to join the people, to come to the temple, to come to church.
Yeah. Although we wouldn't have church until we called it that as Christians, right?
Yeah, yeah. But
and then God came among his people again. Jesus was born not in a fancy building or a palace, but in a very common place. His first crib was a manger, a feeding trough for the animals. One of the names Jesus was given was Emmanuel, which means God with us. God at this point is moving out of that temple and among his people again.
And you know, in the same time, the temple is there at the center of religious life for God's people. And in fact, Jesus and his followers visited it, which was what every good Jewish person did. On one occasion, as they're leaving the temple, one of his disciples said to him, "Look, teacher, what huge stones, what wonderful buildings." Jesus' reply, "Do you see those huge buildings? Not one stone here will be left on top of another. Every stone will be thrown down."
Jesus said the temple would be destroyed, and that took place about 40 years after he predicted it. Why did this need to happen? We can talk about political issues between Rome and the Jews. But part of what was happening was that God wanted to be among the people, not confined to one meeting place.
You know, among the last instructions of Jesus given to those following him were, "Go and make disciples," and "You will be my witnesses from one end of the earth to the other." Well, it took a while for that to actually happen.
The gift of a father, the promised comforter, or the Holy Spirit, empowered his followers and turned Peter the denier into Peter the preacher. After that, the followers of Jesus stay in Jerusalem. They're meeting daily in the temple courts. They're doing something that is very important and good. Acts 2:42 says, "The believers studied what the apostles had taught. They shared life together. They broke bread and ate together. And they prayed." Nothing wrong with that.
No, those are good things. And they were supposed to go out, but as we said, go full, not empty. Well, they had been filled with the Holy Spirit, so that's definitely not empty. And they are studying together, they're sharing life together, they're praying, they are being filled up, they're being prepared for their work.
But it will take a drastic event to push them out. The group is still staying in Jerusalem. They haven't left. But Jesus said to them, you'll be my witnesses in Jerusalem.
They're doing that.
You'll be my witnesses in all of Judea and Samaria.
Not yet.
And you'll be my witnesses from one end of the earth to the other. Definitely not that. This is a good start. The church is growing in Jerusalem. What about Judea, the provinces around Jerusalem? What about the ends of the earth, the other countries?
You know, it's going to be the death of the first martyr, Stephen, who is the first one who dies as for the sake of his witness that pushes the church into the whole world. And by the way, the word martyr actually comes from the Greek word for witness. We read that a great persecution broke out when Stephen was killed. The followers of Jesus were scattered, and Acts 8 verse 4 says, the believers who had been scattered preached the word everywhere they went. Okay.
We think it might have taken between 1.5 and 4 years between Pentecost and the death of Stephen. God is once again exactly where he wants to be, among his people. Through those who follow Jesus, he is walking among people of all kinds, in all sorts of places, in all sorts of countries. He is no longer confined or caged by human buildings.
You know, I think a lot of people sort of think of spending time with God somewhat like going to the zoo. I don't know about you. Do you like going to the zoo to see those magnificent animals? Lions and tigers and elephants and giraffes. Oh my, it's wonderful what God has created. But you know, when you go home from the zoo, you leave the animals there. You're not supposed, just in case you didn't know, you're not supposed to take the lions home with you in the car.
For some people, going to the church building is like visiting the zoo. That's where God lives. And after you visit him, you can leave him there. You can leave him safely and go home. But that has never been God's plan. His new temple is you, the follower of Jesus. This lion wants to not only ride in your car, but on your motorcycle, in the bus, the ankot. The church is not the building. It's you where you are.
And so, you know, here's the thing. God's new model is not come in here to this place and then the priest, the pastor, the leader, the whatever, you know, is going on is going to bless you. No, God's new plan announced by Jesus is I am sending my temple, you, out to where the people are. My people will bless this world.
As Waldemar and I read of Saul's persecution of the early church, and he was part of Stephen's martyrdom. We're thinking of COVID and our situation. All of us are suffering by not being able to meet in one place. You know, when we became pastors at BIC, we dreamed of putting these services online from the very beginning.
Yeah, we did.
It took this pandemic to push us out and force us to go out in all the places we now go online.
You know, as we follow Jesus, we are supposed to go out. You know, God himself became a human and went out. He left his heavenly throne for a time to live in human form. We too, we, the new temple of God, are to go out. So right now, God has not only pushed BIC out from a building, and for a time we believe, we look forward to when we can gather together again, but he's also moved every member of the BIC community out into this new setting.
And you might be new to the BIC community. Welcome. Welcome to BIC Online. We're happy that you're here. And remember that you and I are not sent out empty. God has given us his Holy Spirit. We as pastors, the ministry team, and the leadership team are working to prepare you. We're encouraging you in prayer, in Bible study, and in reading. We pray that you are filled with his knowledge and goodness. We pray that you develop the fruit of the Spirit, that love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, gentleness, faithfulness, self-control, so that as you go out, that you don't go out empty, that you go out full.
Our talks over much of this season of COVID have been focused on this. As we follow Jesus, how do we grow to be like him? How do we get filled up? You know, we may not be able to right now to meet physically as the whole big congregation, but we can do Bible studies together, like the one that meets every Monday morning. There are small groups that meet, study, and pray together.
So the young professionals meet on Tuesday night, Jakarta time. The kids, the preteens, meet on Wednesday. There are many ways that you can meet. So just contact us if you want to be part of a small group.
Yeah, absolutely. Josh works with a number of people on coaching, entrepreneurial training and vision, and various aspects of discipleship. Claudia continues to work with the worship teams in developing their skills and their ministries. And we have a digital media team that's responsible for making sure that this is prepared for you each week. There are a lot of ways that you can participate, that you can also be built up and become full.
And let's not forget the kids.
Oh, yeah.
You're a big part of what's happening at BIC. Jesus paid a lot of attention to children. So you're also a part of what God wants to do in going out. Your parents and your Sunday school leaders want to help you know God better so that you can talk about him with your friends. And you guys have a Sunday school meeting right after this.
Absolutely. So in whatever way we can help you be prepared, we want to do that. Let us know what we can do. You know, we talked a bit about whether we should say, go full or don't go empty. We decided that both are correct. We'll never be completely full. If you wait until you're full, you may never go. But we also prefer to be positive, to not have like do not, you know, don't go empty statements. They sound too negative, but here's the thing.
God is not sending us empty. When you begin to follow him, he puts his Holy Spirit in you. He's in the process of preparing you and pushing you out so that you go out and make disciples. At BIC, we have each other, and he's prepared and is preparing his portable temple, his people, through whom he once again wants to take his place among all peoples. And we at BIC are part of his plan. Wherever you're serving, wherever you're worshiping, you are part of God's plan in this world.
You are the tent. Your body is where God dwells and meets people wherever you are, the church. So I'd like to pray for you. And, you know, Rosemary, why don't you pray first for those who need to meet God?
Lord Jesus, we just thank you that you call us to follow you. We thank you so much that it's not some arduous, some dutiful, some ritual thing that we have to do. But you've asked us to open our hearts to you, to the work that you've already done, to the forgiveness that we have in Jesus Christ. You yourself took our sins to the cross. And the good news is that Jesus, as God among us, has taken our sins. And when we accept that, you come in, you live in us, you forgive our sins, you make us clean, and you give us the power to serve you. And Lord Jesus, if there's some listening who haven't made that decision yet, we pray for them, that their hearts would be open, that they would say, God, I want everything that you have to offer. I want to go out and tell good news, but first I want good news in my heart. I want to open myself to your forgiveness and to new life, to having God living in me so I can live a good life for him. And Lord Jesus, I pray for all who will pray this prayer this morning that you would come near, forgive their sins, live in them as you live in us as we follow Jesus.
And for those who have already decided to follow Jesus and those who are deciding that right now, may we indeed go out. May we seek opportunities to engage with you, to engage with your people. May we search for you in the scriptures as we read your word or listen to your word. May we engage with you in prayer and pour out our hearts before you. May we use the Psalms and some of the different things that we have talked about as ways of spending time with you and being filled up. We thank you that you have given us your Holy Spirit, that everyone who is your child has your Holy Spirit dwelling within them, and that you are preparing us for what you desire to do. I thank you that you were not willing to just stay in a cage, the zoo, a temple, a building, but you have become a part of your church going with us. Actually, it's more like we are a part of you, taking you out into the world and carrying you wherever we go. We thank you, God. Amen. And now enjoy the kids as they say their verses. And then we're going to come back and do a few more things together.
The Lord makes firm the steps of the one who delights in him. Psalm 37, verse 23.
Psalm 34, verse 7. The Lord makes firm the steps of the one who delights in him.
Psalms 34, verse 7. The Lord makes firm the steps of the one who delights in him.
Thank you, kids, for sharing those verses with us. We love those, and we hope you adults are learning them along with the children and with us every week. We're going to do two things now. One is a symbol of what we've received from God, and it proclaims the Lord's death until he comes back. And the second one is another response, which is a response of generosity. First, let's join at the Lord's table. This is part of growing together and going out full. And if you need something to eat and to drink, this is the time to just pause the video, go grab that from the kitchen, and then come back and join us again.
So, everybody who's received salvation and forgiveness of sins, and maybe that's something you've just decided or are deciding it right now, you are welcome to join us in celebration of what Christ did for us. Paul says, "For I received from the Lord what I also passed on to you. The Lord Jesus, on the night he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, 'This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me.' So please take your bread and eat together with us, his body broken for us."
And in case you're wondering, you don't have to have ritual bread. You don't have to have a ritual wine. What's important are the symbols. All right, we believe at BIC and in open communion, if you are following Jesus, you can participate with whatever you have at hand. And so in the same way, after supper, Jesus took the cup, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me. For whenever you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. So please take your cup and drink with us his blood shed for us."
Jesus, we thank you for your broken body, for your shed blood. We thank you for coming to this earth, for leaving your throne, your palace, your place in glory, and becoming one of us to save us. We thank you for that salvation. We thank you for healing. We thank you for restoration. We accept all your good gifts in your name. Amen.
And as a response to God's generosity, we're going to ask you to be generous as well. We're going to be really transparent here. Some of our giving is down, as some of you have lost work and maybe aren't tuning in as often as you were before. Some of you are used to giving in person, and we're working on that.
different ways to give. But here are the ways to give today. Be generous with your tithes. That's about a tenth, whatever you decide, of your income, of what God gives you. And then in offerings, we're going to have a special Christmas project. Mm-hmm. We're going to be feeding some children this Christmas. And so be generous as God has generously given to you. All right, here's how to give.
Check out ways to give to BIC here.
Please join us now in a closing prayer, the collect, followed by a blessing or benediction, and then some final worship. Thank you so much for being part of BIC Online this morning with us and many others around the world. Almighty and everlasting God, increase in us the gifts of faith, hope, and charity, that true love, that we may obtain what you promise. Make us love what you command. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen.
Amen. And now, as a benediction, a parting blessing, we want to say this. For all that God can do within us, for all that God can do without us,
thanks be to God.
For all the Spirit wants to bring to us to fill us, for all the places the Spirit wants to send us to go out,
thanks be to God.
The blessing of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, be with you and on your way together now and forever.
We go in peace to love and serve the Lord
in the name of Christ and the power of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
See you next week.
Follow where your Spirit leads. Broken as my life may be, I will give you every piece. I hear you call. You
Has declared that there is naught I owe.